Hello, 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 everyone. Thank you for tuning in. I am Jay Lee. This is Jay Lee's Corner. This is my review for The Have and The Have Nots. This is season 5, episode 14. And guess what, y'all? I don't have a headache today, so we should be all good, all set. Tonight's lipstick is Urban Decay. It is called Hex. I've worn it before. You can get it from Sephora, and I love it, love it, love it. Yeah, that's my shirt behind me too, guys. That's the Be Big shirt. So don't forget, if you want to get your Be Big shirt to be beautiful, intelligent, and gifted, to check out the link in the description box below to get your shirt. Thank you. Anywho, so this episode, my battery lows as usual. This episode picks up right where the last one left off. Wyatt is still at the damn ATM machine, trying to get some money out. It ain't no money up in there. He has no idea. So, you know what I'm saying? At this point in time, I feel like the drug dealer, who was mad because he's like, I want my money. I need my money. I want it, want it, want it. But I'm like, but you the dummy who gave a stranger drugs without paying you. So my thing is, if you don't get paid, it's your own fault. I mean, my thing is, you should never give somebody something. It's like a thing of, you never loan out something you can't afford to not get paid for, basically. Or you can't, don't loan money out if you can't afford to not get it back. You gave drugs away to a stranger. You did. I mean, excuse me. What I would have did was, I would have said, check your balance. Let me see you check your, because you can check your balance at any time. And if you let me check your balance and I see that you have all this money available, then we can wait. But you ain't did that. You just gave him them drugs and this, and I'm gonna wait. And now it's just stupid. You're a dumb drug dealer at this point in time. So Wyatt is mad because he's like, the card ain't working. Something wrong. He's like, all right, man, I'm gonna fuck you up, man. I want my money, man. He wants his money. And Wyatt like, let me just call the bank and figure out what's going on, because I have the money. And at this point in time, the bank like, you ain't got no money. Like, your money was transferred out, and we don't know what's gonna do. You can't, like, I didn't transfer no money. I didn't act, you know, I didn't request that or nothing. They're like, well, you had to come into the bank to get it fixed or to fill out paperwork to have it stopped. He's like, y'all in another country. Well, that's what you get for banking somewhere that's not local, okay? And they're like, well, you know, that's our process. You have to come here to file a grievance to stop or whatever. He pissed off because he like, I'm broke. I ain't got no money. Like, I have no money. None. Zero. Silch. And now the drug dealer dude, who was technically, that is Mitch's uncle, okay? He like, look, now I gotta kill you. And I'm like, well, that's bad business. Because if you kill him, you won't get paid. Like, ain't the point of it to get paid? Like, I don't want to go. If you kill everyone who don't pay you, you never get paid. It's just not smart. Okay, you can beat him up a little bit, but don't kill him. Like, beat him up a little bit. Take the keys to his car, because it's a fancy car. Okay? Or even say, okay, you can't pay me your money. You need to sign your car over to me. And that'll be payment for the drugs. But he ain't think about that either. Why? Because he's a dumb drug dealer. Hannah back to work for Catherine, but I thought Hannah was gonna be the supervisor. What are the maids at? I mean, why is she the only maid we see in the house? We know they fired the last maid who were talking about stealing, but I'm like, what are other people at? So Hannah do say how she gonna think about hiring the people because it's a huge house. But she, you know, but being there working takes her mind off of all the other things that's going on. It's a lot, okay? So we see that, and we see Catherine saying, you know what, I wanna do something special for you. I'm like, well, girl, you've done enough. Like, you hired her back, you gave her a raise, she got a promotion, you gave her a house, you hooked her up with a man. I mean, what else can you do? What's left? Is you gonna, she don't need a kid, you know, you can't bring your grandson back. You gave her a makeover. She got a nice little wig now. She got her ends straight and everything. I mean, you've done so much already, Catherine. So, so stupid. At this point in time, we see Jim coming in. And what did she, Jim come in smelling like Badussi. And you know what I'm saying? Because he came from being with that prostitute. And what's Badussi? You know, is butt-ass pussy. That's what he come in smelling like. And she like, you know what, Hannah? Can you fix up the guest room? Because my husband is up here and smelling like last night. No, he smelling like a whore. Okay, that's what he smells like. Like a whore. And Hannah like, I ain't got nothing to do with this. I'm going to go clean. Get the room set up. I don't want to hear about your escapades or with this hookup or whatever. I'm done. I'm tired. So she leaves out. Jim goes to the bathroom. And he is in Catherine's room. I be like, bruh, get the fuck on somewhere. Go back to the hotel, bruh. Don't come up in my space like that. Nuh-uh. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Anyway, he's in the bathroom. I guess he's trying to get fresh enough from, you know, being with a whore. And he calls Sarah. Now, Sarah is the assistant DA who is on the case. So, we ain't heard about the damn case. What's on the episode 2 or 3? I don't remember. Anyway, it's only a couple episodes in, so I guess I haven't heard about the whole case about Jennifer Sellison yet. So he calls Sarah, and she is the one who he slept with before at the hotel. He like, I need you to get your ass to the hotel. And I'm like, when Jim tells a female to get her ass somewhere, it makes my skin crawl. Like, it makes me feel dirty. I just don't like when Jim, it's the whole Me Too movement of, oh, he's a person with power and he's forcing people. I just don't want to see it, basically. I just don't care about it or whatever. But, I mean, she just says, okay, fine, or whatever. I'm like, ugh, it just makes me gag. Catherine's phone keeps ringing when she was talking to Jim. And he like, man, ask your phone. So when he went to the bathroom, Catherine's phone must not have caller ID, or she might not have Wyatt's damn number saved in her phone, because it was Wyatt calling, because guess what he need? Some money. He like, Ma, I need some money. She's like, Wyatt, I'm not buying you drugs, Wyatt. No. He's like, no, it's not that, you know, I owe someone, I have to pay them. If I don't pay them, they're gonna kill me. Now, any other parent would be like, what? Where are you? What can we do? Not Catherine. She was like, what? No one's gonna kill you. What's going on? I'm like, why is she so calm, girl? If your son is a drug addict, and if he says, I need you to bring me this money or the people here are gonna kill me, typically it's true. Why is it true? Because your son is a drug addict. So, you know, she like, look, he not gonna kill you. It is what it is. I'm like, well, you should know he's serious because he called you 18,000 times before you answered. And you know what I'm saying, when he's saying like he's gonna kill me, she's like, no, he's not. The dude in the back like, no, I'm gonna kill him. I'm like, well, god damn it, you can't, don't say it on recording. So at this point, she's like, okay, fine, I'll come to you and I'll bring some money. Where are you? Like, I'll send you the address. I'm gonna text it to you. Now my thing is, why couldn't he say I'm at the bar, costly, effective, or whatever, I don't know what the bar name is, but you know what I'm saying, I'm at Lucky's bar, I'm at Nikki's bar, I'm at the bar and grill on some, oh, say something. Okay, I'm making the kind of bars here in Michigan. So the drug dealer at this point is pissed off, and so he go hitting Wyatt in the head with his gun. I'm like, but you just heard them have a whole conversation and someone gonna bring the money. So as a drug dealer, sometimes you have to learn patience. Okay, it takes time to cook up drugs. It might take some time to get the money. He told you his account messed up, but he made a phone call to have someone bring your money. What you beat him up for? Boy, stupid. So at this point in time, we see Justin at work. So he's at work. His boss comes in. I'm like, you know, Justin, are you okay? You know, your mom's been calling. She says you haven't been talking to her. You know, she's friends with the mayor. You know, they call me. It's all these things. Like, is everything okay? You know, they're asking me if I'm working too hard. Like, what's going on? He's like, no, it's fine. I'll call her later. Now, remember, Justin's mother is Candace's old white neighbor who was nosy as hell. That's Justin's mom, that old nosy white woman who lives across the street from Candace. So, but he is avoiding talking to the mom and also his wife, too. Because at this point, you know what I'm saying, the boss's boss asked him, you know, Jeffrey, Lord Jesus, Justin, come to my office. This, let me talk about something with you. And when Justin goes in there, the dude, his boss, shows him the video that played in court of him and Jeffrey. He's like, it was all over the station. Everyone's seen it. Like, it's talk of the town. Like, look, like, I don't need no details about what's going on. You know, I don't care about that, but you need to just get it handled one way or the other. You know what I'm saying? You know, you need to do whatever you need to do. I don't care. He's like, oh my God. Okay, fine. He's like, you know, Captain, you like, what's your advice? What should I do? He's like, off the record? He's like, yeah, off the record. He then says, like, look, you need to make sure your family is okay. He says, if your family isn't okay, all you're doing is making more enemies. And when he said it, at first I said to myself, I looked at it from a standpoint of, if I am a gay person and if people just don't accept me because I'm gay, I don't care if they're okay. Because at that point in time, I feel like they don't care if I'm okay. And I thought about it a little bit longer and I said, I don't think that's what he's saying. What he's saying is, you have things going on and you haven't talked to your family about it yet. So what you're doing is, you're avoiding them and you're making more enemies because they don't understand what's going on and they feel slighted. I said, okay. So it took me a second to get what he meant by that. And he then said to him, you know what I'm saying, but now, you know, call your mom and call your wife. He's like, how do you know I haven't talked to my wife? He's like, it's a small town, you know, it's a small office. Because again, they're cops, his wife was a judge. You know what I'm saying? It is what it is. It's the same thing, when, you know, in certain fields, conversation and rumors and situations travel. If you work in a hospital, the conversations between the doctors go to the nurses, it just spreads. If you're in an office, it goes from the president, the CEO, to middle management, to lower management, to regular folk. You know what I'm saying? It goes all up and through. I remember hearing a rumor a long time ago when I worked at a law firm that one of the lawyers was sleeping with one of the paralegals, and it was crazy because word literally traveled throughout the whole office. So it's not far-fetched for coworkers and people to know different stuff, because again, it's a small office and word travels. So, at this point in time, we then see his mama pop up to his job. I'm like, everybody just popping up. Okay, his boss popped up to talk to him. Now his mama popped up to talk to him. And she, you know, pulls me like, let's have a conversation. You're like, all right, mom, let's go. So she like, I saw the tape of you and that color boy. I say, now did she just say colored? You old little racist white woman. You know when a white woman say colored, she's being racist, right? You do know that, okay? Because otherwise, you say you was caught in a predicament with that man. With that color boy. I say, yep, she's an old white racist. So, he lied and said, I was undercover. She's like, stop lying, Justin. That's not true. You're a liar. She then brings up, like, this is the same thing that happened when you were a kid. And you got found in a compromising position, a situation in a locker room with that other little boy, and you know what I'm saying, I don't like it. I didn't like it then, I don't like it now. And I'm like, well, Justin's a grown ass man. He's a grown ass man. But you kind of now see why he acted out these urges in the backseat of squad cars with criminals, because you feel like I can get these urges out and they can't do anything about it, and because they kind of feel ashamed of it, they probably won't talk about it. So that's why you can clearly see his mom has probably always told him, that's nasty, you're dirty, you're going to die, you're going to go to hell. And so he took that to heart because it says in the Bible. So he took it to heart. So that's why he is acting that way. You know what I'm saying? And it's not right, honestly. So, and that's the thing that people have to realize. You can't want to alienate someone based on their sexual preference. You need to love them regardless. I hate when people are like, I can't like them, they gay. Well, you straight, so who gives a hell, girl, bye. So when she said, you know what I'm saying, I don't like it then, I don't like it then, he like, all right, mom, whatever, I just, you know, I don't have anything to say about it, it is what it is. And she says, fine, you know, you're out of my will, you hurt your wife, you embarrassed the family, you're awful, you're just awful. You know, you can't come to family dinner, you can't come over or anything until you apologize to your whole family, you ruined your whole life. I'm like, damn. And he just says, okay, I understand. I'm like, bitch, damn it, Justin. Now, Justin is crazy. He needs some help, but I think he's a thing of, he's a repressed gay person, meaning he hasn't accepted it yet, so he's kind of in just stealth mode to not show any emotion about how we feel about it one way or the other. And so we see that whole thing. You know, we then next we see Candace trying to transfer that $8.9 million from that business account to her personal account. I'm like, she thinks she's slick. So she's trying to transfer the money, and they're like, you know, you can't do it. So she has to push a little number, whatever, to figure out what's going on at the bank. So she talks to the bank people or whatever, and she's like, you know, I'm trying to transfer money from my business account to my personal account, and I don't know why it's not letting me do it. And they're like, oh, there seems to be some kind of hold on it. And she's like, what hold? You know, it's $8.9 million. It's my money. Why can't I transfer over? And she's like, there seems to be some kind of federal hold. I've never saw this. You know, let me get my manager. And so then here come the manager. And they like, you know, yeah, I don't know what this is very weird. There's a phone number and address here. So I don't know what this is. But, you know, it's a hold on. And until they take the hold off, it's going to be on it. She's like, well, what's the phone number and the address so I can call myself? They give her a number that she has to call. She calls the number. And Landon answers. I'm like, God damn it. Charles then put a hold on that girl. Look, you know how tough Charles can be watching her to know for a fact that she did his whole scheme? I'm like, he's watching her every move. Because you put a hold on a transfer to her personal account. I'm like, bitch. Rich, I love Charles. I love him. I'm kind of mad we haven't seen him yet, because I love Charles, but I know he's coming up soon. Anyway, so she's like, who's this? And he's like, hi, Candace. And she's like, who is this? And he's like, it's Landon. She's like, Charles did this? I can't believe it. And he's just like, yeah, Charles froze the money. He wants to see you. He wants to talk to you. And she's like, I know. Tell him if he does not unfreeze my money, I'm going to the press. And I said, press about what? Girl, he had, first of all, if he froze $9 million from your account, if he had your brother arrested, if he had your ass locked up in that room and had you scared he's going to be going to Guantanamo Bay, you think he can't stop you from talking to the press? Candace so stupid sometimes. I just can't deal with it. But anyway, she said, you know, tell him don't, you know, release it or I'm going to the press or whatever. And she hangs up. Stupid. Benny and Melissa don't end up getting together. Let's just say that now. Clearly because they in the kitchen. It was such a little scene to where it's a thing of, she's like, I'm tired. Every time I walk in the room, you walk out. It's just stupid. So she basically was just starting an argument. And he realizes that and said, you know what? You should be nicer to me, nicer to us. You know, you're in this nice house. We don't even know you. You're a stranger. But my mom let you live here. You know, she let you be here. You should be happy about that and not be so mean, rude, or whatever. And she's like, whatever. You're stupid. Whatever. He's like, see, you like that. You like causing conflict and arguments. You that's the kind of person you is. And he said, you know, okay, I get it. I see it or whatever. What are you talking about, Benny? And I'm like, girl, you fool nobody. Anyway, then Mitch come over, him and Mitch leave. Bye. Hannah new boyfriend pop up. Hannah new boyfriend Derek. I know that's not her boyfriend, but she likes him. He likes her. And he pop up to the house when she's about to leave and gives her flowers. She's like, what are you doing here? He like, you know, Catherine told me to come by at 6 to fix whatever. And I kind of figured it was about you. Oh, you just happen to have flowers? He said, well, I was going to give you flowers anyway. They was in my car, and I was going to leave them on the porch. So, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, now, here you go. You know, can I take you out to eat? She's like, no, I got to get home and fix dinner for my son. I said, Hammond, your son is a grown-ass man out here slinging a tow truck dick. He can get his own food together. He really, really can. But then when she said, but you can come over for dinner, I said, okay. At least you not playing him for Benny. Because Benny can starve for all I care. So, yeah, she told him, like, you can come over to the house. And I'm a cook, and you can eat, and we can, you know, talk or whatever. So, and she likes him, and he likes her. It's cute. You know what I'm saying? It is what it is. Next, Justin. Justin, go get Jeffrey out the cell. Like, you know, Harrington, you're free to go. I'm like, you did this before already, Justin. He don't believe you. So Jeffrey sat there for a good minute, like, I ain't getting up because he fucking with me. I ain't playing with him. And he's like, Harrington, no, for real, you're really free to go. So he comes out of whatever, he handcuffs him, takes him to that same little nasty interrogation where he's been touching people or whatever. And he like, am I really free to go? He's like, I got an apartment. And he like, okay. He like, and so you can live with me. And he's like, what? He's like, no, I don't think that's smart. He's like, well, come on. I don't want to live there by myself. You know what I'm saying? You have nowhere else to go. He's like, no. If I'm not free, you know, take me back to my sister. Like, no, you're really free. You made bail. But I want to, before you left, because your dad is out there waiting on you, that I have an apartment. Just come to the apartment tonight. Just come and be with me. I'm like, it's almost sad and scary at the same time, because Justin don't know how to be without Jeffrey. And Jeffrey likes Justin. He just don't like the craziness that Justin does. And that's the weird part. It's cute to see Justin be like, I got a place we can be together. I like you. I don't want to be crazy. But it's also crazy because you've been molesting me this whole time I've been locked up. And you know what I'm saying? You kind of loopy or whatever. And I don't want to do that. So Jeffrey like, look, I don't know. I got to go. Let me out of here. So, you know, up front, it was weird because when Jeffrey basically said, no, I don't want to live with you. I'm going to leave right now. And then when he's up front seeing his dad, and he's like, you know, I need to find somewhere to live. And then David looks at Justin as in Justin's kind of just eavesdropping and listening. He's like, you can stay in my car and don't until we get you an apartment. Because I think he know I don't want him staying with that crazy man. So I'll just put him up in my old condo. And he can be there until we figure something else out. So at the house, you know, David and Jeffrey go try to look for the condo keys. But they walk in the house, Erica naked. Okay, she's trying to get it on with David. Oh my God, I'm so sorry, I can't believe it. So that whole thing. So she's embarrassed, she runs upstairs. You know, at that point in time, you know, David and Jeffrey talk a little bit. It's cute to see how Jeffrey said, like, do you like her? Like, who is that? Oh, it's a girl I've been dating. Yes, I do like her, whatever. He says, I can tell you like her. He said, because you smile a whole bunch and you never smile with mom. So that's a whole good thing. He tells his dad how his mom wanted him to sign something to blame everything on Benny to get Benny locked up. And he like, you know, I was going to do it. I was thinking about it. But I felt bad because, you know, Benny didn't do it. He's like, well, did he not do it for real? Like, no, Benny had nothing to do with it. It wasn't him at all. And that would be wrong, right? David then said, there's a lot of things that are wrong in the world, son. I said, well, God damn it, David. He said, but, you know, even though I don't like the kid, you know, we can't do that to him. So, you know, he like, don't worry about it. I'm going to get you off anyway. I'm like, well, it took you too long to get him out of jail in the first place. So, I mean, if you say so. But that's the whole thing. We do see Candace then calls Veronica, basically for some help. Asking her to get a federal judge to release her money. Veronica like, bitch, you was wasting my time. And she basically hung up on her because Candace would not explain, like, what was going on. So Rock like, if you can't tell what's going on, bitch, I can't help you. Click, and hung up the phone on her. So at that point in time, we see Justin back at work. This time his wife pops up. Can we talk? He's like, yeah. They go into another interrogation room, and then she's like, here. He's like, what's this? She's like, divorce papers. He literally pulled out a pen and signed them. Didn't read them, didn't ask no questions. He just signed them. And she's looking like, this motherfucker just signed them. Like, he wants to divorce me. I think she didn't think he would just sign them. Just like, okay, here you go. John Hancock. And she's like, just like that? Without a thought? And he's like, you know, it is what it is. And she's like, you know, do you love him? Justin doesn't reply. He doesn't say yes, but he doesn't say no, which basically means yes. And she's like, you know what? I can't believe you would do this. You've thrown your whole life away. You've ruined your whole family. I hope it's worth it. And all he said was, you know what I'm saying? I'm sorry. I can't say anything else besides I'm sorry. She says, you know what? You also signed the restraining order, so you can't come within 100 feet of me. So, you know, you signed the divorce papers and a restraining order, because I hope he was worth it, because you lost everything. And she then gives him a key and says, there's a truck downstairs with all your stuff in it, because I want to no longer know that you exist. He says, what about my daughter? And she says, oh, you'll never see her again. I said, damn, bitch, he can't see his child anymore. She said, you know, you signed that right away too. Now my thing is, I think legally you can tell someone these are divorce papers, then you make them sign the divorce papers, restraining order, and a thing to lose their rights as a parent. I don't think that's legal. I don't. And when she walked out, he started crying. Because he was sad. We forget that Justin is a full-fledged father. He had a kid. Like, I don't think I remembered that, you know, from 2 seasons ago. So that whole part was crazy. We do see Veronica talking to a judge. I'm like, okay, Veronica gonna be nice and she's gonna find a judge for Candace. No, not at all. Veronica's at her old judge friend, who I'm pretty sure at one point or another she slept with him. And you know, she's like, I have, you know, my son's fiance, she's pregnant, she's suicidal, you know, she wants to kill herself, this and this and this. See, look at these doctor notes when she wants to kill herself. You know, she's just a danger to herself, she's a danger to my grandchild. And I think, you know, she needs to be committed, you know, just to the baby's born. I'm like, is it that easy to get someone committed? Because if it is, I'm scared. Because people don't like me sometimes. I can be very loud. People like, oh, you bitch this, you bitch that. I don't want nobody ever been able to go to a judge and say, Jay Lee be on YouTube going off. I think she's crazy. Let's lock her away for like a month. I don't want that to happen. So I want to safeguard myself from being committed to a guy named on psych ward. So he's like, oh, wow, that's kind of crazy. Yeah, you know, we can't have her out here. You know, what do you think we should do? Well, can we get her committed like as soon as possible? He says, well, yeah, but I'll need to have her, what do you say? I need to have her monitored. Yeah, like I would have someone evaluate her. I would have to have someone evaluate her first. And she said, can we do that today? I'm like, it can't be that easy. It cannot be that easy to get someone committed. Like, it should be, like, to get someone committed, you should have to first be questioned to see if you sane. Because how do we know that you ain't the crazy one and you trying to lock me up because you crazy? Because in this case, this is what's going on. But whatever. So I'm like, Lord, please save Melissa. And so the ending scene, we see, you know, Wyatt never sent his parents the address. Because Catherine and Jim was like, where is he? He didn't send us the address. And they don't know where he is. They can't trace his phone. It's just kind of crazy. So we see back to the bar. Drug dealer man is still beating Wyatt up. Like, I can't believe you don't have my money. It's just stupid. I want my money. He's like, man, I just need the address so she can bring the money. This is why I say he's a dumb drug dealer, because he's saying to you, all I need is what's the address here? I don't know where I am. I'm in the middle of nowhere. Tell me where to tell them I am. I would ask that question when I was on the phone with them. I would have hung up. I would have said, well, what's the name of this bar? And it would have been thinking, okay, this is the name of it. Google it and then get here. Okay, that's what I would have did. However, you know, he's being beaten up, whatever. He's getting tired of being beaten up. And I'm like, look, again, you gave your drugs to a man with no money, and now you're beating him up because you want said money. But what he need to give you the money, you won't give him, is because you're stupid. And at that point, that's why what happened. Why you got tired of being beaten up? You grabbed a beer bottle, pow, busted over the bar, broke it up, and now it's a weapon. And what did he do? Stabs the uncle in the neck. I say, now see, I've seen people survive neck stabbing, so we can't say that he killed him. He at least hurt that man because he stabbed him, did it, and that's how the episode goes off. So it was a good episode. You know, things are progressing a little bit here, a little bit there. We shall see. Other than that, though, I am Jay Lee. This is Jay Lee's Corner. Peace.